And I thank Sahasra ENT Foundation, especially Harsha, for taking up this task of conducting these webinars in a regular basis. And it has been happening for the past 1.5 years. And so many people gave lectures, and many people got benefit out of this. So without wasting much time, we have planned this temporal bone dissection program into 3 lectures. And the first one will be on the how we need to set up a basic temporal bone dissection lab, and how we, what all we know, we must know about the drilling techniques that we are going to do, drilling techniques. Then that is the idea of the today's lecture. So now, so first of all, let us ask ourselves as to why we should do a temporal bone dissection at all. Why we need to, why can't we directly do surgery on the patient? Because we all know that temporal bone, the two middle ear and ear, is a very small area surrounded by important structures around, which are delicate and fragile structures. Especially we have neural tissue, we have vascular tissue, and we have sensitive ossicles, and all the important structures are surrounded by, the middle ear is surrounded by very important structures, wherein we'll be using fine, sharp instruments with a high speed drill. So all these things made temporal bone dissection, temporal ear surgery, is a difficult one, not only difficult one, but also a fine one. So where we need to use a very high speed drill. Suppose in case if we don't have a drill control, then it may go and touch the important structure surrounding the middle ear, and which may result in catastrophic complication. So these are the things that made temporal, we need to learn all the basic handling of the instruments, then get the drill control and learn the anatomy under microscope. See, the what anatomy we read in the book is entirely different from what we actually practice in the on the patient. Because the ear anatomy is most of the times, if you know that in undergraduate days as well as the postgraduate days, it is the very difficult one, which needs to understand, we need to understand by doing a dissection, three-dimensional anatomy, not the textbook anatomy. So now, how, what are the ways that we need to learn the, how we can learn the temporal bone dissection is now. First is, you take a dry temporal bone and read all the parts of the temporal bone and anatomy, and then get familiar with the anatomy. Then we must also know that the exercises are different from surgery. See, when you do a temporal bone dissection, it simulates the surgery, but in fact it is not surgery, because when you do temporal bone dissection, there is no bleeding, number one. Number two, there is no pathology in the middle ear. So these are the thing that makes the temporal bone dissection different from the surgery. So now we need to understand the surgical anatomy under microscope. So what you read is different from what exactly you see and do. Then next is, then we need to get used to the instruments and microscope. See, when you do surgery for the ear, so not only we use both eyes, but also both the hands. One hand will be holding the suction, other hand will be holding the drill or a micro instrument. Then your both eyes will be onto the microscope. Then your both legs will be occupied, and the right leg you may be using for the drill and the left leg for the diathermy. So now all your legs, two legs and two eyes and two hands will be working, and the mind behind this is the most important thing. So to get used to this way of how you use the instruments, the psycho, these are called as psychomotor skills. See, it is like nothing but driving a car. See, when you start driving a car in the initial days, I hope you all remember that you see a gear, which gear you are going, is the first gear, second gear, third gear. Then as you become more experienced driver, by just knowing the position of your gear, you know which gear you are driving in. And also with experience, you will know that by the sound of the car, but the sound of the speed that you go and the resistance that is offered by the this steering, you will know that which gear you are going in. It is like driving a car is like doing a temporal bone dissection or ear surgery is just like that. As experience, you get more and more experience. Automatically, you will start doing things like how you drive a car by an experienced driver. So now, once you learn the dissection, learn the anatomy of the dry temporal bone, what are the parts of temporal bone, then what structure passes through which foramen, all these things first you must learn on a standard anatomical textbook. Then first you start doing dissection on the dry temporal bone. So when you, the advantage of doing dissection on the dry temporal bone is because they are easy to get, and the only difference is that there will not be any soft tissues. So that's the only thing. So in those things you can do some mastectomies and facial nerve we can expose, and labyrinthectomy you can do, except you cannot do you cannot do facial nerve decompression like a fresh cadaver. So then once you get used to the instruments and you master some techniques, then you start doing in the wet fresh temporal bone, because we all know that getting a temporal bone to a wet temporal bone will not be so easy these days because of so many reasons, which I don't want to go into the details of those things. It's all your hard work and your connections with the forensic people or anatomy department. How you get bone is up to you. But this is the first you do a temporal bone dissection and a dry bone, followed by the wet temporal bone. So a temporal bone, you have to show them how they should cut like this. The approximate measurements are like this. If you cut a too small bone like this, then the important structures will be cut. If the specimen whoever gives you, suppose if they give a very big bone, then it will be difficult for you to fit in the temporal bone holder that is designed for. So the ideal bone should be of this dimension. You imagine this much should be the dimension of your cutting, then only you can fix properly onto a temporal bone holder. We all know that the temporal bone holders to get these days will be very difficult because of so many reasons. But when you don't get temporal bone, then still you have to learn by other techniques. So now there are other techniques of learning temporal bone we'll be dealing with. So learning by hands-on, that is more than reading or seeing YouTube or seeing a dissection manuals and CDs and other things. If you do yourself, then that is nothing like doing hands-on dissection is the most ideal thing. So we have to get the acquire how you feel the drill, how the drill will run from away from you and create a complication. And all those things we need to drill. That means you must understand the use of drill and get used to the drill and get the drill control. The most important thing is drill control is a primary thing that you learn in the temporal bone dissection. So never think that if you do 10 temporal bones or 20 temporal bones, you are a master of ear surgery. Every temporal bone or every patient is different. So what exactly you learn on doing temporal bone dissection is that, number one, psychomotor skills that are, excuse me, sir. So what you learn from, sorry for that, you will not become an instant and get the drill control. If you know how to use the drill properly, then your 30% of your surgery is done. And the next is the acquiring the manual dexterity by use of the microsurgical instruments. And this is the stepping stone for the successful ear surgery. So you have to do at least 20 to 25 dissections before you move on to the patient live surgery. So that's a very important thing. So when you don't have access to the temporal bone, so then what other modalities that we have? In some countries, temporal bone dissection or dealing with the human parts is not done. So they do a sheep temporal bone dissections, and there's something called as Pettigrew temporal bone dissections. In Britain, they use Pettigrew bones that we'll be dealing with. And then next is when you don't have this access, then we have something called a simulation and virtual reality as a high fidelity. That means they have a software wherein you hold your mouse and then keep on, when you press, it starts drilling the bone and your hand will have the same vibration as you drill the temporal bone. So these are some of the safer alternatives on learning the thing. This is called as a Pettigrew bone. So each bone, it is available online. In Britain, you can get them. And you can get a normal Pettigrew temporal bone, or you can order a bone with a disease also they can give you. And this is the bone, how you fix it onto the wooden rack. So this is a special wooden rack where you fix the bone. Like, it's not like a rotating temporal bone where you fix the the temporal bone holder. So this Pettigrew temporal bones are made of some synthetic material, wherein they'll have a temporal, you have a tympanic membrane like this in the Pettigrew temporal bone. It will be just like a human tympanic membrane. And if you want a cholesteatoma on that, they can give you with a cholesteatoma in the attic region. Or if you want a perforated tympanic membrane, they can give you that. And you see, this is a Pettigrew temporal bone where dissection is done on a see, you can see this is a modified radical mastectomy is done. You can see the facial canal, and this is a stapes, this is a tympanic membrane, this is a dural plate, sinus plate, and the tip area. It will be just like a human temporal bone, which is made by man, the synthetic material. So this is available in Britain, you can get them. The normal bone you can get, and also the diseased bone you can get. So this is a Pettigrew temporal bone workshops will be conducted in some of the countries where human parts are not allowed to use. So this is a Pettigrew bone with a perforation. So then the next is the dissection simulation by a, see, this is how you will be seeing through in the microscope, and you will have the same feeling of seeing a temporal bone like this. And when you start pressing here, then you know this drill will start moving, and this is your suction. You can manage, this is your suction and this is your drill. You can start drilling and you can move the suction. This bone disc will be coming like this. And when you hit a important structure here, so then it will show that you have hit that important structure and you have created a complication. So it will be just like doing a temporal bone dissection, the virtual dissection simulation. But it is, the software is very expensive, and we think it will be in the lakhs rupees. So only the institution can afford to have this facility. So this is how you learn the dissection. So now let's start from our basics of how we start doing the dissection and what all we need to procure before you start doing a dissection. So now you should have a good temporal bone holder. Now you see this temporal bone holder, it has got 3-point fixation, and this has 4-point fixation, and this has got a 6-point fixation. So the best one would be to have a 3 or 4-point fixation like this. So these are available, this 3-point fixator is available in commercially in the market and various places. Only thing is, this fixator should be like this, but whereas it is coming from below and going like this, so this will be difficult for you to fix the bone. So you need to understand that what is an ideal temporal bone holder. So this is an ideal temporal bone holder. Actually, this is designed by one of our ENT surgeons. And so this is actually a 4-point fixator is a very good one. So this will be kept on a ring, a tenecoid ring, what we play with that ring. So that will be, you can move the temporal bone holder forward, backward, and turn like this. So this will be kept in a tray like this. So these are various temporal bone holders available in the market. The ideal one, you should know what to choose for your dissection. Then once, then next what you need is a bone. So the temporal bone, fresh temporal bone, it's very difficult to get to these days. So once you get a bone, you have to use it to the maximum extent possible. You can do almost all the surgery on the bone. See, now you see this is a fresh temporal bone with a tympanic membrane and deep canal intact. And you have to fix this temporal bone in a surgeon's viewpoint. This is called as surgeon's viewpoint. So this temporal bone is fixed into the this one. So this is a right temporal bone that we are dealing with. So this is the, so we need to understand that this, there are some terminologies you need to understand. See, when I say superiorly, that means you understand that it is always pointing towards the brain, superiorly brain, towards like this. this is superior. Inferiorly mean towards or foot, like this. Anteriorly mean towards the face. Posteriorly means towards the occiput. Okay. Medially means towards the brain. Laterally means towards the exterior, towards the cortex. So these are the six: anterior, posterior, superior towards the occiput, inferiorly towards your foot, then medially towards the brain, laterally towards the cortex of the bone. So if you understand and imagine that these are the terminologies, once we start using superiorly, it should be like this. So this is a surgeon's viewpoint. So you need to clean the bone in such a way that all the soft tissue, everything is cleaned like this, and there should not be any muscle or periosteum which will come in your way of drilling. So clean the bone in such a way and then fix the bone in the bone holder in the surgeon's viewpoint. So now next is the, we have bone, we have temporal bone holder, next is the microscope. So microscope, these days we are getting with the LED microscopes, and most of the microscopes are LED. It has a power control, power on, off. Then we have an illumination increaser, and then we have a handle. Then these are the eyepieces. Then this is the magnification changer. That side we'll have fine focusing. So this is the parts of the microscope. Then once you get, the most important thing is we need to know that you have to use a 250mm lens. This is the lens with a 250mm object. Then next is the, we have to adjust the interpupillary distance. So when you start doing the ear surgery, so most of the times, first thing is we need to see in both, once you keep the eyepieces laterally, and then you see the object inside through the microscope, then you will see the two, the bone has two images. So then once you start moving the eyepieces like this, these pieces like this, then at one point, you see the two images as one. So that is your interpupillary distance that will be measured here. So this interpupillary distance varies from person to person. So you have to adjust at every surgery when you do interpupillary distance. And only when you have, when you see two images, that means through two eyes, when you see image, it should be viewed as one. Then that is called as your interpupillary distance. Then only you will understand as a depth perception. If you start seeing the image as two images, many people still operate struggling like that. So that is not done. You have to see two with two eyes, one image, that is your interpupillary distance. So this is a must, and you should always know what is your interpupillary distance. Next, when you are using spectacles, spectacles to operate through the microscope, and there is an option in the microscope, you can plus and minus, you can adjust your diopters here, but most of the things, ideal thing is you use your spectacles and operate through the spectacles and keep this in the eumetropia. That means don't keep in plus one or plus two, plus three or minus two. Keep this as a neutral one, this is a neutral one. So this is the basic thing that you need to do when you start doing the ear surgery. See, this is the emetropic. Okay, that's normal. When you start moving your this one, then if I keep these two here, that means I am seeing through this as a plus two. So instead of doing that, you can always use your spectacles and keep it in the this one. So this is the set zero, and start working with the lowest magnification and know your interpupillary distance by moving this. So this is very important to understand before you start doing ear surgery. You have to get used to your tools. If you don't know how to stab or how to cut, so you cannot win the war. So you have to, not only you need to have all the weapons with you to fight with the enemy, but you should also know how to use them at appropriate points to get the best results out of it. So now the next important thing is the microscope. This is a temporal bone holder. I was telling you about this is a 3-point fixator, and you have to keep it in a ring like this so that it will not move or wobble. Keep it in a tray. So next is your chair, what you sit. So the chair should have a backrest like this, because when you sit for a very long time, maybe hours together, your back needs support, and it should, you should sit in such a way that you will not bend like this and you will get your damage your back. Then your feet should always touch the ground. you should not be never in the, you should be always rested either on the footrest or on the ground, but never hang in the air. So that's very important. The next is your hands should rest on the table like this. So if you keep operating like the hands are on the in the air, so then you start moving your hand and then there'll be tremors and you will not do a perfect job. So this is how you should sit. So this is a chair we use for the surgeries. Very expensive one, but it's worth spending this chair. And this has got an adjustment of height back and front. This can move and this height can be adjusted. It's a very good surgeon chair. Even if you sit for 3, 4, 5 hours also, your back will be supported very well. And it is a very good investment for an ENT surgeon. And so this is a good surgeon's chair that you have to have when you start operating. So now let's understand what are the micromotors that we have in the market and what are the drill systems. See, the conventional micromotors that we use in our practice are having only 15 to 20,000 RPM. That is rounds per minute. This is 20,000 that we use for the temporal bone dissection. And when we start doing ear surgery, and there are available in the market, high-speed micromotors are available, which will have the tune up to the tune of 60 to 80,000 RPM. And we need to know what is a brushless motor and what is the motor with the brush. So let us see that. So now this is a basic micromotor that you will be given when you go to do a temporal bone dissection workshop. So this is called as the control unit, where it has got two switches. There is one on and off, and the other one will be there where you can make your drill to turn towards right, clockwise and anti-clockwise. So then you have to give it to the power connection. And this is the foot pedal. This is a micromotor, and this is the handpiece. So now we have four parts. This is the control unit, foot pedal, micromotor, and handpiece. So these are the four parts of a working micromotor. So this is the basic one. So then this is a motor with the brush. So we'll tell you what is a brush. Brush motor, the disadvantage of this burr is when you remove your, when you don't want to drill, you remove your leg from there, don't press it anymore, then still the burr will move. It will not stop instantaneously. The moment you remove the foot pedal, it will still rotate for some time then before it stops. So that is the biggest disadvantage of the micromotor with a brush motor. That means when you don't want to drill, you remove your leg from the foot control, this is the foot pedal, but still it will rotate for a while, which we don't want usually. Suppose inadvertently, still it rotates and touches some important structure, then it causes damage. That is a major disadvantage of this particular micromotor. Whereas a brushless motor, the moment you remove your leg, it will stop, it will stop drilling. So this is a micromotor, which is a, this is a brushless motor. And the rotation will be around 40,000 RPM. This will be around 60,000 RPM. Then this is around 60,000 RPM. Then we have something called as variable foot switch. That means the more you press, the more fast the burr will move. So this is a variable foot switch where your RPM will be shown in the digital form here. It will be quite expensive, but and it has a irrigation system too, where when you are using a very high speed drill, so the handpiece, the handpiece and the micrometer will get hot. So this will be cooled by the coolant tube that you are connecting to micromotor, and the saline will be controlled, flow will be controlled by the control unit. So these are the very good micromotors that are available in the market. So where you have excellent tools today. Then we have a striped handpiece like this. Another one is a contractile handpiece like this. So this is useful. This contractile handpiece is useful when you are doing dissection in the deeper planes and when you want to do fine drilling in the extraordinary canal or near the posterior tympanotomy, you require a contractile handpiece. But the disadvantage of contractile handpiece is that the regular, suppose this length of the shank which goes inside will be more. So that means when you want to use contractor hand piece, you must have a very long burrs. The size of the burr should be longer than what you use in a straight hand piece. So all these finer things will not be told in any lecture or anything. That is the reason that we have taken this task of teaching you the very basics of this thing. So after once we finish our surgery, so then we have to lubricate from this side to this side with a lubricating oil. So this is the latch. So once you fit the burr inside, you have to close there like this. Then only then it will use, it will start, the click sound, you start doing the drilling. So we need to understand some terminologies here. This is torque, means the ability of the handpiece to withstand the lateral pressure on the revolving tool. That means when the burr starts moving and when you start cutting the bone, it will be, there will be some pressure exerted on the handpiece. So that determines the torque. So this is the more expensive burrs will hold the lot of torque they will hold. So that is the bearing capacity, that will have a ball bearing capacity. So where, and you should never try to drill with the tip, that will be coming to the later. So now you see, these are the drills, hand the oil available in the market. So this should be applied. So the most important aspect that we need to understand is that this drill oil should not go into the micromotor. So that is the wrong notion. That suppose this is very, maintaining of your instruments is very important for a successful surgery, because not only you should become a good surgeon, but also you must know that very important thing is to maintain the your instruments in a good working condition. Suppose you have only one burr and you feel that your assistants will do a very good cleaning and leave it to them, they will put them in the saline or wash it, then you will go for the next case and you don't have a handpiece. So you must always spend some time after you do surgery to maintain your instrument for the longevity, and what you spend for them, you should take care. So you must spray from this side and to this side, and this oil what you spray, and then you keep them in the upright position like this for some time, and then before you use. So this oil has to drain from all the handpiece. Suppose if this oil goes into the micromotor of this micromotor, this oil should not go inside of this micromotor, then it will get spoiled. So these are the things that you must understand and maintain the instruments, not only buy an instrument, but also to maintain how to give a long longevity. So the next high speed drills available today in the market are this Visavo drill, up to 60 to 80,000 RPM, and very good drills are available. This is one more. This is the control unit of the same thing, and you must understand what drill that you can do and what amount you want to spend on a drill is very important before you start buying. So then we have another drill that's called the Skeeter drill. So this is a very light drill, it's like a pen. So this is a drill that is used in stapes surgeries. It's a very good drill that whoever is doing stapes surgery. This is again a Skeeter drill. And so let us understand something, what are the burrs, types of burrs, and then how they are useful and where they are used. See, according to composition, these burrs are divided as stainless steel, tungsten carbide, and combination of both. According to purpose, what you use, they are called as cutting burrs, diamond burrs, and polishing burrs. According to length, they are classified as long, short, and medium burrs. According to motion, they are called as right burr, that is clockwise. But this we don't use in our practice, don't bother about it. So that we need to know that the burrs are stainless steel burr. The advantage of stainless steel burr is that they are very fast cutting, but the disadvantage is they rust very fast. They are not very expensive and they go rusting at a very early stages. Tungsten carbide burrs are very brittle burrs. They break if they fall down, but the cutting efficiency is not very fast as steel burrs. But the only advantage of tungsten carbide burrs are they are long lasting. So you can use it for many, many cases before you throw them. That is the advantage. Then the cutting burrs are used for the removal of the cortical bone, and they are very fast in removing the bone. And diamond burrs and polishing burrs are used at important structures like dura, facial nerve, and vessels, near the vessels, and to polish the cavity. Then long, short, and medium burrs are where we use, we will come to know in the, I will be explaining you in the next few slides. Then when you want to classify the burrs, they can be classified as round burrs, inverted burrs, conical burrs, cylindrical, disc, and long cylindrical. These are according to the shape, you can classify the burrs like this. See, this is a round cutting burr. This is the cylindrical burrs. See, the cylindrical burrs or conical burrs are basically, they are not intended for otological work. See, for our otological work, these are round burrs of varying sizes are recommended. But we are using these conical burrs, which are actually intended for the use in the dental lab. So these are very aggressive, fast cutting. These burrs, which are used to cut the metal actually, and to shape the dentures, what they make in the lab, they use these burrs. They're ideally speaking, these are not intended for the otological work, but still we use them because of their efficiency in removing the bone is very good. And you can use it, but only disadvantage is they are not very long. They are only up to 50 millimeters they come, and the working length is very short. So that is the disadvantage, but they are very good, available in the various dental people, they are available. So, and we have another long slender conical burr. This one will be very useful for you to do canalplasty with this. So these are the various shapes of the burrs that are available in the market. So then let us know something about the cutting burrs. So the cutting burrs, as I said, they are aggressive in bone removal, and available is various sizes and shape. They start from, the cutting burrs start from 0.6 millimeters to 7 millimeters is available head, and various shapes. They are available as steel and tungsten carbide. Various brands are available in the market. So they are available as long burrs, short burrs, and medium burrs. See, the advantage of long burrs is that you can use it in the depth. When you want to do a depth work, you require a long burr. But the disadvantage of long burr is it will wobble. That means the burr will just shake like this when you specially operate under high speed. But the disadvantage of short burr is the handpiece will go near to the bone where you drill, and the irrigating fluid may come and fall onto the handpiece, and it may spoil the handpiece. And you have to be very, very near to the bone. Medium burrs are about, see, I can tell you that the ideal burr for doing ears, cortical mastoidectomy, modified radical, will be roughly around 50 millimeters burr, long burr is ideal, because this will not wobble, it will be stable, and it will not run away. So, and when you start using long burrs to cut, then to hold the burr for a long time, the two burr is wobbling, your fingers will get, you know, tired, and on long run, you will develop tremors. So there is a disadvantage of using a long burr. So the ideal burr should be somewhere around 5 to 5.5 length will be ideal, but I use that those burrs. So now let us see what are the parts of burr. So this is the burr, if you think that this is a burr. So this is the head of the burr. So the size of the burr will be known by the size of the head of the burr. This is, suppose if it is 5 millimeters, then it's called a 5 millimeters burr, 4 mm. This is the length will be differently mentioned. So this is the head, this is the neck, and this is the shank. Please remember, this is called as, this rod will be called as a shank. So this shank thickness is universal for all the burrs. Okay, this will not be changed. Okay, only the length of the shank, only the only the length of the shank, this one is variable, and the head size changes, but this thickness, what is called as the shank size thickness, will never change. That you have to remember. This is universal, and it will, so that unless it is universal, it will not fit into any hand pieces. So that's a very important point that you must understand. So see, this is the length of the, this is the length of the bar, and this is the diameter of the shank, and this is the length of the bar, and this is the diameter of the bar. So now the size of the bar will be from here to here. Okay. Head also includes in the size, and some part may fit into the handpiece, and this is what it is visible. When you use a contraangular handpiece, most of your shank will go inside. So that means a bar which is comfortable with a small, that is a straight handpiece, will not be comfortable for a contraangular handpiece. So that is the thing. So you have to understand that. So that means shank defines the length of the bar, the length varying from 25 millimeters to 90 millimeters, but commonly we use 50 and 70 will be little longer. So please note that, and it has the shank has a constant diameter of 2.125 millimeter, that is the thickness of the shank. Then we have something called as notched burrs. That means if you see the burr end, it will have a notch in some burrs. So these burrs are useful for a high speed drilling, and this the notch will go and fit in the latch in the handpiece will be there, that will go and get locked inside. Okay, this is about the burr. Now you see, these are the cutting burrs, this is a round burr, and you see the various, it starts from 0.6 millimeters burr and to 7 millimeters for the maximum. So, but most of the times we use in otology work, when you want to do mastectomy, so this is the burr. These two are constantly used burrs, 5 and 4.5. And when you want to do a modified radical mastectomy in a very big cavity, then you do 6 and 7. These are larger ones. Commonly used are these two. And as you go deeper inside, then you start using the smaller cutting burrs. So this is the conical burrs where we use for the canaloplasty. They are available with the dental people. And you see the various shapes and sizes that we get all these conical burrs. So this can be used depending on the situation where you can use available in the market with the, see the shank of the burr is very, so this is the short burrs available with the dental people. They're very, very aggressive in cutting. So when you use such shaped burr, never try to cut with the tip of the burr. It will never cut. Most of the time is the side of the burr which will cut the burr. Never try to cut with the one. So now let's see what are the parts of the burr tip that we see. I'll not go into the details of these angles. Please read yourself what are these angles. So the burr will have some rake angle, clearance angle, rake face, and clearance face. Just understand these four terminologies, how the burr tip works like this. This is the rake face, this is the rake angle. Please read yourself. I will not go into the details of this physics. You read yourself. It is given nicely in the slide share. One of the dental people have got a very beautiful presentation on the drilling this angle. You can go through. I will not go into those details. So these are the notched burrs. This you can see the notch here. So this notch is going to fit in the latch of a high speed drilling burr. So these are expensive burrs, this high speed burrs. And then this is a diamond burrs. You have fine diamond burr, you have a regular diamond burr, and you have a coarse diamond burr. You see, this head is the most important thing that we know all of this one. Then this is the working part of the burr. So this will be rotating, but the working part of the burr is the head. So these are the diamond burrs. This is the fine diamond bar, this is the coarse diamond bar, available from 0.5 to 7. Again, these are the various sizes available in the market, and you can have various shapes and sizes available like this abrasive bars. And remember, when you use diamond bars, you require, it produces a lot of heat, you require a lot of saline irrigation, and it is used near the important structures like this. And one more advantage of diamond bar is that it is it uses to reduce the bleeding from a bone. So it like works like a cartridge, because it pushes the bone into the bleeder and then it stops the bleeding from the bone. There's one more advantage. So then we have something called as curved bars like this available, this, but it fits only some drills like this. You cannot use this bar with all the drill bits, that hand pieces. These are fits only some of the hand pieces like this. They are very useful cutting bars. We have diamond bars. They are used in the cochleostomy and canalplasty. Curved bars are also available these days. So we must always remember that. Just a minute. Instrument is a tool, but it is not a substitute to the surgeon's knowledge and skill, because whatever drill you use, whether it is a high speed drill or low speed drill, the most important part of the drill is your mind, your hand, the holding the instrument, and the mind running the instrument through your hand. This is the most important thing that we need to. That means we must have an eye and hand coordination, which is controlled by the mind. Then we must have a, see, these are the suction irrigators available in the market. So you don't require an assistant when you do a ear surgery or temporal bone dissection. So you can collect some water through this one. And then once you start drilling, the suction automatically, saline falls onto the field, and then you can start drilling. So this is one way of doing the dissection. So now let us know what are the do's and don'ts of drilling. See, always when you, for a right hand surgeon, use the hold the drill like a pen with the right hand and suction like this, and always see this, like hold like a pen, and your little and the ring finger are resting on the patient if you are operating on the patient, or on a temporal bone holder, so that you will have a very good support of the hand when you start drilling. You will not get tired if you take support like this. Suppose if you just hang your the hand in the air, it will be difficult and you will not do drilling for a long time. Then you hold the suction like this and then you start. So the most important thing is your suction, your drill should never hit the suction. This very tricky situation. In the beginning, you start drilling the suction tip, and then all the metal pieces you will see in the field, which should not be done. So this is what you must learn in the temporal bone dissection, that you must not drill haphazardly, and you should not touch this, and your bulb, when you want to drill, you should not run away from you. So these are the things that you need to learn when you start drilling. So then, see, this is the short length bar and this is the medium length bar. So when you start doing a dissection in the early part, you must have a short length and largest possible bar, and then cutting bar. As in we go deep and deep this one, then you take a long shaft burst. So now these are the things that we need to understand, that you hold the drill like a pen or pencil and take the position of your little and ring finger, rest there, and always take the rotating drill onto the structure. That means you take the drill to the point where you want to drill, keep it little away, then start the drill, and then once it starts drilling, then you take the drill towards the place where you are working. Instead of that, never do go and keep the bar on the bone and then start pressing the foot pedal. Then once it starts, it will jump from there. So that is very important. That means you take the bar to the place where you want to work, keep it near to that, then you on the bar, then start drilling. That is the way that you need to drill. Then always use the largest possible bar area, because if you take a small burr, it will plunge inside and then it may go into the brain or may go into the sigmoid sinus. And if you use very large burr, one of the disadvantages is that it may produce large dural abscesses, or it may, you know, hit the, suppose if you, I will show you when we start seeing the drilling practically. So always your direction of drilling is towards the long axis of the structure. This is a dural plate, you drill like this. This is a posterior canal wall, drill like this. Never like perpendicular to it. Always in the long attitude like this. If you drill like this, you may transect the tissue. That's a basic drilling technique. So then parallel to the structure, you may expose the facial nerve, but you will never damage. If you do like this, you will cut the facial nerve. And when you use a small burr, it may go and hit the facial nerve like this. Always, you must see what you are drilling. Never drill like this from below upwards, where you cannot see what you are drilling. And when you start drilling here like this, sometimes your burr may catch the soft tissue that is on your temporal muscle or soft tissue, and it may curl like this, number one. Or your assistant put more water here, more saline, then the anterior canal skin or the soft tissue will get caught in the burr and it will become into pieces. We will be showing you some of the examples that as to how we drill. So now you see, this is a brushless motor I'm using. See, oh, I'm sorry. Oh, my. No, no, this is not. Hello?
Change end slideshow and restart, sir.
No, this is my end show.
Yes, sir.
How to do this?
Keep discard. Yes. Restart.
Yeah, okay. See, now you see, I am drilling from the more risky area. I am coming from below upwards. See this? I am drilling near the attic. See? I am drilling below upwards like this. And see, my assistant is not putting enough saline here. That is the reason my bone, my drill is getting clogged. This should not be done. There should be some adequate irrigation. See, I am drilling from below upwards, not the other way around. See, in this patient, you can see there is an exposed, anteriorly placed and very superficial sigmoid sinus is there. So I am taking care not to touch with that cutting burr that I am using. See how I am doing. See, I am drilling on the facial nerve. See, I am drilling on the lang axis. See, when I use, I am doing osteoclastoplasty, I am using 0.6 mm diamond burr under microscope. See how stable is my drill. It is not running from the bone. This is how you must select your size of the burr. So use adequate irrigation so that your burr will not get, see, my burr got clogged because this assistant was a new person, was not putting the adequate saline. See, this burr efficiency will come down as the bone gets deposited in between the teeth. That should not be done. See, when I drill along the dural plate, my axis is, see, again, watch it here. See, like this, but never like this. And when I drill near the sinus dural angle, again I come up from below upwards, not the other way around. See, I'm going from below upwards. So this is how you must know how to change your direction of the drill when you start doing the, see, when I drill on the facial nerve like this, see, on the long axis I'm doing. So this is the osteoclastoplasty using a diamond burr. Now you see, when you start doing the temporal bone dissection, so what you need to do is, you need to check the, see, this burr is moving in a clockwise direction. So suppose your assistant will keep in an anti-clockwise direction. Now you see, backwards like this. So if you start, if you now with this backward direction, if you want one, it is not possible. So always you must know the burr, how it is moving. See this. This is a brushless motor. See, once I stop the burr, say I stopped burr, still it is moving for some time. That is a big basic burr. So the whereas that, see, when I stopped, all again it is moving. That is the brushless. See, now you see the direction of drilling here. I'm doing a mastectomy. See, the first cut is made along the dural plate like this. Second cut along the posterior bony canal wall, and third cut along the. So this is a triangle of attack. See my direction of the burr along the Lang axis. So there is no important structure here in this triangle of attack, so that my burr is moving. See, this is actually an unedited video. You can see I have taken just 1 or 2 minutes to open the antrum. See the amount of bone that is the burr is removing. This is a fast cutting, high speed drill. I'm using a steel burr. You can see, this is not an edited video. You can see the amount of time that I have taken to reach the antrum is not more than 1 or 2 minutes max. You can see I've already opened into the master antrum. Again, you can watch, see how the burr is moving. I'm not keeping any pressure on the burr. The burr is moving from one place to other, and still it is removing the bone very nicely. Just touch and go like that. See the amount of burr that is being removed. So the most important thing is the burr that you are going to select, and the handpiece and the system that you are using is the most important thing for the drilling time. So your drilling time will be minimal, so that you can spend more time on reconstruction. See, when I drill here, I come from below upwards, and when I drill here, I do like this. When I drill here, it's like this. Here, this is the basic thing of drilling. If you can understand and practice this, your 50% of the surgery is done. See, I open the antrum. The first thing that we see when we open the antrum is the lateral sensorial canal bulge. See, drill like this, like this. So this is the right to left and left to right. And again, you see, when you drill, when you want to expose the side, when you want to expose the additus, and when you want to see the short process of the incus, see here, we know that the short process of the incus is there. So you must be very careful not to touch the incus with the burr. And you must also know that the dural will come more inferior here as you go near to the middle ear. The dura, what is here, this level will be lower in the tympani area. That means if you think that the dura at the same level here, you will open the dura and lead to a CSF rhinorrhea. See, I am drilling from below upwards and exposing the, see the direction of drilling, and see now we have exposed the incudomalleolar joint, and see the direction of drilling. You should never touch the ossicular chain with the burr. See how I am drilling from below upwards to expose the anterior attic. So that means you are drilling near the tegment tympani and the ossicular chain. See the movement of the burr is from below upwards, taking care not to touch the vital important structures like dura and ossicular chain. So this is how you must learn the basics of drilling technique in the temporal bone dissection. See, when I was doing a, hello,
sir, your screen share got,
I don't know, suddenly,
Can you restart your screen share, sir?
Yeah, now, it's okay?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, this is a wrong burr that I used here. See, I started using a, see again, I'll show you, cutting burr. When in a hurry, there are 2-3 cases are there. When you're in a hurry, you have to use a diamond burr here. Instead of that, I used a cutting burr, and the result was this. You can see this. The assistant will put more water, and see, the skin became peeled. This is a common mistake that everybody will do. So never do this in your practice. Always use a diamond bar and then cover these flaps with a, see again I have to put the skin in the normal way. It will take more of your time. Never do like this in your practice. Always put these flaps in the anterior position. Protect them with the, either with the, see the, I can do it, but the thing is it takes more of your time. Protect these flaps with the cotton ball or the silver foil that is comes with the suture material. Never use a cutting bar like that. See, now I am drilling on the facial nerve like this. See, I am using a diamond bar, using a profuse irrigation. See, I am drilling on the near the facial nerve, the cutting bar I am using. So once I start here, then see, I will change my bar into that. See, I change my bar into the diamond bar with a profuse irrigation on the lang axis of the facial nerve I am drilling. See that? See the level of the, see, facial nerve that I made. This is an open cavity. Is almost I come to the level of the facial nerve. If you don't remove the bone here, then the part, this part you cannot see and it will be like a sump effect. So you have to drill the facial nerve like that. When you are doing a canalplasty in the anterior part, especially here, so sometimes you may end up in the opening the temporomandibular joint. You have to be careful and see how I am drilling here. See the direction of drilling like this, from like this, and always use a diamond bar like this. Diamond bar, and see now the size of the external canal or after drilling. So this is a success. See, most of the time our anterior perforations are a failure because you don't secure the graft anteriorly properly, because it takes more of your time and require a lot of technique to drill the anterior canal wall. So the canalplasty on the anterior part is the key to the success of surgery. You see this preoperatively, how much bulk, see, I cannot see the anterior angle clearly. So in this situation, it will be failure if I don't do a canalplasty. See, I have taken more of my time in doing canalplasty. See how much bone is shaved off with the, see the skin is reflected anteriorly, superiorly, and see now this much of drilling needs to be done. So this is how you must drill, keeping the temporomandibular joint in the view. Sometimes it may be exposed and you have to expose the sinus tympani. See, this is the cholesteatoma patient. This is a deep sinus tympani is there in this patient in a intact canal wall technique. See, very deep. So see, you take the double diamond bar and then remove the margin, posterior margin like this. See how much drilling I have done. This is a stapes and you see how much drilling I have done and I expose the sinus tympani. So this is how you must know what size of the bar to be used at what given point. See, if I take a big bar, my bar is going to, see again, you see, if I take a big bar here, see, if I take, this is a 1 mm or 1.5 mm bar. If I use 3 mm bar, it goes and touches the stapes, that will be a catastrophe. So that means your bar selection to the given area is the most important thing that you will learn in the temporal bone dissection exercises. See, this is a very high speed drill. Harsha? Hello?
Sir.
Hello?
Yes, sir.
Harsha, how much time I can take more?
You can take, sir. No issues. You can go ahead.
Because now it is 8:30. It's already, I think, 1 hour over. So I'll be dealing
with participants.
Yeah. See, this is a high speed drill. See, accidents may occur if you don't. See, this is my own surgery. I am not ashamed to tell that I have created a complication. See, after 22 years of experience also, you can create a complication. If you say that you don't have a complication, that means either you are lying or you are not operating at all. I can tell you confidently that, see, this patient was operated by me some 4 or 5 years back. See, this complication that has happened in my own hands. See, this is a drilling. When I was drilling here, I exposed a sigmoid sinus in a cellular mastoid. Suddenly, when I did not notice that that was the exposed sigmoid sinus. See this, this was sigmoid sinus was here, here. It got exposed, which I did not notice. See, it got exposed here. I did not notice. And see, that is the end result. So the patient had severe torrential bleeding like this. You can see this bleeding. See how it is bleeding? So now you must stop this bleeding. So you have to be very careful and vigilant when you use a cutting bar, especially of a high speed drilling bar. See now how to control bleeding also you will learn when you damage a sigmoid sinus. Never be get panic. So first take a ribbon gauze like this and press against bleeding like this. See, it will still bleed like this. See how it is bleeding. Don't get panicky. See, hold it for a while. Then bring a big piece of gel foam bigger than the defect into the field. A compressed two-layered gel foam like this. See, bring it onto the defect. It should be bigger than the defect. Mind you, it should not be a smaller one. See, I'm replacing the. See, I'm replacing the ribbon gauze with the. See carefully how it is done. So this can happen to anyone. Never keep suction on this now. The suction will suck away the gel foam. Never keep suction on this. So press against. Yes. Then now you take a ribbon gauze and press against it for 5 minutes by watch. So now it gets stuck nicely. See, bleeding has stopped. So now you bring a soft tissue and keep it on this and you can proceed with the surgery. So this patient had a cholesteatoma after. It was up to here, see, and I have also taken care post-operatively so that somebody tries to clean here and hit the jugular bulb exposed one. So I kept a posteriorly based musculoperiosteal flap to, it serves two purposes. Number one, it protects the jugular bulb and also obliterates the cavity. So careful that it may happen to anyone. And now in this scenario, I am using a 0.6 mm burr. So you can always make a facet. See, I have taken a septal cartilage. I am making a small facet into the cartilage by a small 0.6 mm burr so that it will, this cartilage is going to come and sit on the, see, this is a stapes. This is an intact internal wall tympanoplasty, limited cholesteatoma. You can see this is the body of the incus, long process, short process. See, this is going to sit like this. So you can use a small burr in a controlled manner under microscope to do osculoplasty also. So that is how you can use your burr. And you can see in another scenario, you can use a 0.6 mm burr to make the facet onto the head of the malleus like this. See, this burr will not move. This is a 0.6 mm burr used to do osculoplasty. You can make the facet. So this facet will be about 0.7 mm. in diameter, which will exactly fit onto the head of the stapes with a snugly fit. You can see this one. See, it will never fall down. So if you use bigger burr than this, it will fall down. So remember that if you do facet for the cartilage or the head of the malleus, you have to use a 0.6 mm burr. So the cutting efficiency of the burr and the speed, when you want to do a superficial bone work, you can use up to 20 to 40,000 RPM. When you want to do foot plate work with a cochleostomy, 1,000 per minute, and deeper work, so you don't require a very high speed burr, up to 20, 40K is enough so that you can finish off your work fast. So this is, So this is running away. This bone, see, if you don't have control over your burr, it will go and run and the important structures like this. See, this is how you must drill the bone and rest the fingers with the on the temporal bone holder or this one. So never try to open the antrum like. making a small hole. That means you are not seeing where your bird is going to hit. So then see what has happened in this live surgery, when same thing was done by a junior colleague. So he has tried to make a small hole into the antrum, and instead he has gone into the sigma and made a rent in that, like a torrential bleeding. So always see, so we have controlled that later on, that's a different issue. But always when you do a mastectomy, cortical mastectomy, widely you open so that you will not find the structure accidentally, but you expose deliberately, that's all. So the most important thing for a successful surgery is that you must have a good microscope, good quality instruments, burr and drill. It's a very important thing that we need to have a very good instruments to get the final result. So always use the largest possible burr for the area given. Use a diamond burr near the important structures. Drill always parallel to the structures that are in question, and use adequate irrigation. Why do we do irrigation is to cool the diamond burr and remove all the bone dust, and then the bone should not get accumulated in between the teeth. That is called as clogging of the bone. So once the bone gets accumulated in between the teeth, the rake angle, the clearance angle will become lost, and the cutting efficiency of the burr will go. So that is how you must, and you must always protect your back on a long run so that you will not have back pain in the years to come. So as you grow more older and older, you tend to develop, this thing, the proper, if you don't sit properly on the surgeon's chair, you tend to develop low backache, and your surgical capacity will come down with the back pain. So our back should be protected well so that we can operate for a very long years in our career. So we must always manage our negative thinking or this one. So repeated practices always strengthen our brain and neural pathways. So if you do repeated practice on the bone, your neural pathways will get strengthened, and skills are acquired repeated practice. It requires repeated practice. You cannot become an instantaneous surgeon by drilling one bone. And skills are learned over time. Always remember that the more you drill, the more you get experienced. So this is how you must drill and learn, and understand normal anatomy of the temporal bone first before you start operating. Then always learn the art of handling the instruments and drill and instruments on a temporal bone first, and then go on to the patient. And you must develop something called as hand-eye coordination, and drill control, and psychomotor skills before you start operating on the patient. So this is the thing that you need to understand. And I just want to share that we had been, a long back, we had been to a temporal bone dissection course in 2007 at Mario Sanna's place. Many stalwarts are here in this photograph. So we must attend. The idea of putting this photograph is that there are a lot of temporal bone dissection workshop being conducted and abroad. Even though the course is expensive, but it is really worth attending. It is a 5 days course where you will have ample time to drill and learn one-to-one interaction, and dissection facilities are much better in those places. And thank you very much for your kind attention. And I also thank the moderator for this session, Dr. Kumar Swami. And if you have any doubts regarding anything, so you can contact me at this is my mail ID, and you can take a screenshot. And we'll be conducting a lot of temporal bone dissection workshop, and you can be in touch with us. And we have a course that is coming up in July. If everything goes right, in the month of July, we are going to conduct a workshop in the last week of July. Thank you very much for your kind attention. Any questions that can be taken, you can ask any questions that we have in the mailbox. Harsha?
Hello.
A moderator. Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. J.P. Reddy. It was a very wonderful and elaborative lecture. It was a very informative. You have given a good insight into how to set up a temporal bone lab and how to do a different drilling techniques. And you have given information about each and every instrument that are we are using in a temporal bone lab, and I don't think we will get this much information in anywhere in the book. And of course, this is all because of your vast experience you have gained. For your more than, I think you have done more than 20 years of experience. Okay, thank you very much for, and even in fact, I have learnt many new things and many terminologies I am hearing for the first time. So there are some questions. We'll take up some questions now.
Yeah.
So there is a question from Hindu. Suppose
yeah.
we have seen sometimes while drilling, the tip is not rotating. Tip of the handpiece is not rotating. Only the middle part will be rotating, vibrating. How to avoid this, or what to do in this situation?
Tip of the handpiece is, see, handpiece should never rotate. If
yeah.
your handpiece
yeah.
is rotating, that means you have to use a new handpiece. Handpiece should not rotate, only the burr should rotate.
Yeah, and another question, how to preserve the wet temporal bone?
Yeah, the ideal way to preserve is a 10% buffered formalin. See, actually, ideal thing is you have to keep it in a refrigerator. But we don't have freezing facilities in our country. So the best way to preserve the temporal bone for a very long time is to store in a buffered formalin. Buffered formalin means you keep 900 ml of water and 100 ml of formalin. That becomes 10%, and it can be stored in that. But only thing is, you have to change this once in a while so that there should not be any smell. So to avoid stinking of formalin and stinking, the room may be stinking because of that. So you can put one or two tablets of Kerpuram in that, so that camphor, so that your bones will not stink. This is how I store my temporal bones.
What about to store in hypersaturated saline?
Yeah, that's also a good point, Kumar Swami. But the thing is, if you put in the hypersaturated saline, what will happen is that all the soft tissue will be eaten away by the salt. And at
yeah.
the end of 1 month or 2 months, you will have your bone will be bare like this. All the soft tissue will be gone like that. So that's all.
So, can you comment on this geared burrs?
Yeah, these geared burrs are used, they are expensive, number one. Number two, they are designed to use for a high-speed burrs that can also be used in a normal burr. But only thing, they are expensive and they are designed for a long, you know, high-speed otology burrs. Harsha? Hello? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Harsha?
Yes, sir.
Can you unmute Dr. Jeevan Ramchandra Galagali, sir?
He can unmute. He's already unmuted, sir.
Yeah. Galagali, sir?
Yes, tell me. Love it.
Yeah, you have to comment.
In a very wonderful lecture. Wonderful lecture and very informative, very educative. Hope we'll see the other two sessions as well, so that our
yes,
PGs can learn. Now that it's a little difficult to attend any temporal bone sessions because of the lockdown periods, I think that's a very good idea. At least you've commented, at least they'll have some idea before they start a temporal bone dissection.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, there are some few more questions.
Yeah.
One of the participants is asking how to fix the can, if it is possible to show how to fix the temporal bone and a holder, temporal bone holder.
Okay. Well, I'll do one thing. Day after tomorrow, I'll show that. Now, it may be difficult to show at this point of time, you know.
Okay.
That can be learned. That is not a big issue. If you attend any workshop, within no time, we'll do that. You will learn, no problem.
And another question, what are the most common sizes and types of burr tips required for this mastoidectomy in our day-to-day practice?
See, that's what I'm telling. See, when you start doing a surgery or temporal bone dissection, you always think that you are doing surgery. Never think that it is a temporal bone. Always treat the tissues as a surgery only. So that means you must have all sizes burrs. That means 7 mm to all sizes burrs you must have. But the commonly used burrs for mastoidectomy are if you have 4, 5, 6, that's enough. But when you want to do acyloplasty or when you want to do atticotomy, so it requires smaller burrs. So always you must have all sizes of burrs in diamond as well as polishing, cutting burrs. That is my advice. Buy everything.
Cannot compromise with the burrs.
Yes.
So another question, how to soften the dry temporal bone? Is it possible?
No, no, see, you can soften the dry temporal bone by putting that, soaking that in normal water, mix it with hydrogen peroxide if you keep. To some extent, it will become softened. And there is no need to soften this bone because your very purpose of doing is that to do just a cortical mastectomy and MRM and then open the, the fallopian canal and labyrinthectomy. So you can do by just soaking in the water or the hydrogen peroxide.
Okay. And what are the books you suggest to read for this temporal bone dissection? These are one of the questions.
See, there are a lot of manuals available these days, available in the market. And the best, we cannot say the best ones. The available ones are the Dr. Mario Sanna's temporal bone dissection manual is available. Dr. Vijayendra or Guru's temporal bone dissection is available. And Manipal temporal bone dissection is available. Then house manual is available. A lot of things are available in the market. You can download any of these things in the PDF formats. Or if you want
Dr. Jayaprakash Reddy.
Yeah.
Dr. Prakash Munka here.
Good evening, sir. How are you?
Good evening. I was listening to your this dissection from first slide. And yes, I tell you, to be very honest, none of the people explain in so much details from the beginning about the position, ergonomics, the burrs, the motor, how is the handpiece is working. It is an absolutely excellent. To the last question somebody asked about the books, I always say, read the living books. Living books are people who are teaching you. Attend their course, look their videos, and see their operating videos. Probably there cannot be anything better than that. And nowadays, probably not in our generation, when we were students, we didn't have the facility of the videos and all that. So our gurus used to say, you watch it, you ask question, you dissect with us. That is the best thing to do.
In our time, sir,
even temporal bone dissection labs were positive. Very few centers had it. So what they used to say, with the bulk of patient information, go step by step, which I always insist. Learning is a step by step procedure. So you follow guru, try to think which is best for you, and then you can do it like that. It is nothing that Dr. X is, Dr. Bijendra is doing like that. I have to do that way. Dr. Jayaprakash Reddy is doing like that. I have to do that way. Dr. Prakash Munka does it like that. So I have no. You have to find your own comfort.
Your own way of learning the things. Yes.
Yes. And our PGs of this generations are fortunate to have so many online courses. If you remember, Dr. Jayaprakash, we used to buy the CDs, you know.
And yes, sir. Yes, yes.
For 1,000, 1,200 bucks and all the big names.
Yes, used to correct. Yes, sir. Yes, yes.
It used to be almost 70% of our monthly salary those days. So, the people have got a lot of opportunity, and I will say these people are more fortunate than us as far as the learning is concerned.
Correct.
Our learning curve was a bit slow, sir, because we learned by doing it, committing mistake, not to repeat the mistake, see others' mistake, and don't repeat the same for you. Excellent lecture. I couldn't find any lacunae that some point you have missed. And so I was very sincere to attend it. It's not
Thank
only
you,
for me, even for the practicing people, people of my experience, we can also pick up one or two practice. Excellent. Congratulations, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Any questions, Kumar?
Yeah. There is one more question from Dr. Gautam. Can you explain the TARCU once again?
See, these are all physics, the torque, and they are not very important to know. If you want to know about the torque, please refer to drilling techniques in the slideshare. It is there by one of the dental college professor. 2-3 lectures are there explaining each and everything in detail. Okay, it is not very important to us. It is just a, see, the torque is nothing but the capacity of the handpiece to withstand the pressure that you are keeping on the bone. That all depends on the quality of the handpiece that you are using, that ball bearing of that. So if you go and compress the bone, see, the most thing that we do, youngsters, what they do is that if they want to cut the bone very fast, I saw in many of my workshops, they will press the handpiece against the bone to cut the, for the intention to cut it fast. So that damages not only your hand but also the handpiece. The torque of the handpiece will come to that one. That is, the pressure that is exerted onto the handpiece by you is a torque. That has to withstand that. So that is why you should never press the handpiece against the bone or use more force to cut the bone. So always your burr should move from one place to other like a pen, and you need to change the burr tips very often so that your cutting efficiency of the burr will be very good. So you should change the burrs if they don't cut actually.
So there is one more question. What magnification should be used while doing dissection?
This is a routine magnification like 6 when you want to do. Commonly it is 4, 6, 10 is available. So 6 is ideal, low, so 4 will be low, and 10 will be near important structures.
Okay. So can you explain the surgeon's position while doing dissection? And also you comment on the chairs. What type of chair is it required while to sit?
See, I showed you the chair what okay. I use in the surgery. Okay. And they can write to me where it is available. I will tell them. You always, whatever chair you use, your back should be protected well like this. You should not bend when you operate like this. That's important.
So there is one more question. In cases of this sigmoid sinus bleed, is that gel foam is adrenaline soaked or just a plain gel foam?
No. You have to use a big piece of gel foam, dry one. If you use adrenaline one, see, the moment you wet the gel foam, it will not have strength. So that will get washed out. You always use a dry gel foam, which is sticky. See, the advantage of gel foam is the dry gel foam is sticky. It gets stuck to the place. So that is the reason you use a gel foam.
What about Surgisil? Is it?
Surgisil, once you use the gel foam, you can always use Surgisil. But the Surgisil cannot withstand the pressure of the bleeding because it will be like a thread, like it will not withstand. It is for a smaller bleeders.
So there is one more question. After keeping the gel foam, which plop was used?
I used a free soft tissue on that. Okay. Then I used on the posteriorly based flap, musculoperiosteal flap.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. J.P. Reddy, for this wonderful session. And also I thank this Arsha.
Dr. Thank Arsha. You very much, Sukumar Swami, for being with us and spending almost 1.5 hours time with us, leaving your busy schedule of practice. And your valuable suggestions and comments are welcome. And thank you very much, Arsha. Hello.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Dr. J.P. sir and Dr. Kumar Swami, sir.
We'll meet Harsha.
Yes, sir.
Harsha.
Yes, sir.
You can contact the moderator on that day. I've given you. You have got his number, no?
Yes, sir.
If you don't tell, you can ask me. I can. Good night.
Thank you, sir. Good night, sir. We'll meet again on Wednesday.
Yeah. Okay.
Thank you.